Thanks everyone for coming. I have to confess at the outset that I have veered somewhat from my abstract. Hopefully not too far, that you, if you're interested in what it looked like I was going to say, you won't be interested in what I am going to say, but it is a little different, so apologies. I'm also going to apologise because I'm going to probably do a lot of reading because I'm still quite jet lagged and we've had three intense days of being London tourists. But to begin, I've been doing what I think of as metaphysics since I began studying philosophy at least, but probably since long before that, perhaps without naming it metaphysics. And I started thinking about optimism in philosophy when I first came across Gödel's particular version and its use in that particular philosophical way. And I'll talk a bit more on that shortly. So the idea that planted itself in my mind then, way back, that I'm just about to start exploring now, was that optimism paired with metaphysics might be a useful concept. Useful in the sense of useful for philosophy and useful for helping us understand things a little better. That's the main idea that I want to make a start on exploring here. So speaking of Gödel, I've also been fascinated with older divisions in philosophy for years and older concepts, particularly the realism-anti-realism divide. That's been my main area of fascination. And I don't think that divide, that division, is to be cast out as old-fashioned or is completely useless, which you might find in the literature if you have a look. But I do think we might need a new way of appreciating some of what it might be telling us and how it might help us inform methodology or clarify theories and so on. And I think perhaps one of the places that the concept of metaphysical optimism might help us is in understanding that division as well. But first, some quick definitions. So metaphysics, coming up with the definition of metaphysics is a big ask, but I'll make a start. So we think about lots of things. Some things seem to have fairly simple descriptions, properties and so on, and I would say deceptively so. So we could say, perhaps with varying degrees of certainty, that say material stuff is made up of smaller bits, its form changes and so on. We tend to think we know and can know quite a lot about these sorts of things, ordinary things. But there are other things that we talk and think about whose nature is far less clear. And that's primarily stuff that we can't access via our senses. Now, these things can be particularly interesting, and they are particularly interesting. I mean, I spent my whole philosophical career studying numbers. But this is not to say that they're fundamentally less knowable or even the sole domain of metaphysics. I don't think so. And I think to presume so at the outset would beg the question. So rather than being about a set of specific or type of things themselves, say abstract things, metaphysics to me, I'm going to say, is the focus on things. So rather than focusing on the thought or the talk or the theories, it's focusing on what our talk, thought or theories are about. So metaphysics takes that inquiry seriously. So it can be asking of anything. It can be asking of physical stuff, abstract stuff, imaginary stuff, human stuff, what it is, whether it exists. It can be asking what it's like, what are its properties, is it real, in what sense, does it relate to other stuff, where does it come from, what comes from it, can we eat it? So metaphysics can encompass all sorts of questions about all sorts of things, from cats to numbers, which, thanks to Benacerraf, are forever linked in my mind, which is funny because he actually brought them together to show that they're very different. So taking the investigation of the subject of our thoughts, theories and talk seriously and as important for its own sake, asking what it's all about, that for me is what makes something metaphysics. So definition of optimism. Well, given the quick definition I've just made of metaphysics, metaphysics itself might be called optimistic from the outset, especially insofar as it already seems to allow, in a sense, the continued investigation of what might seem unanswerable questions. It sees the life in the wondering. That's surely optimism. Or maybe it's just being stubborn. But defining optimism from the start is tricky, so I'm going with Wile E. Coyote. He's run off a cliff. Often, not always, in fact sometimes he's very pessimistic, but often after he runs off a cliff, his feet keep pedalling. He keeps running. That's my definition of optimism to start with. And I know this is getting very technical and I apologise if you're having trouble keeping up. So a definition of metaphysical optimism, well that would be optimism about aboutness. So optimism that we can know, or it's at least worth wondering what our investigations and our inquiries are about. So with these robust definitions in hand, let's go further. Oh, I should point out the talk tonight is in two parts. The first part just goes over some very well-known tales from physics, maths and logic. So see, I'm sticking to the abstract a little. And the second is the philosophy part, more of the philosophy parts, and it discusses what these examples maybe, hopefully, might tell us. So there's a certain sort of boring, or for my purposes, relatively useless sense of optimism, just as there is of realism. So it's optimistic to continue walking, expecting the ground to be under your foot. It's realist as well, for that matter, and that's the sort of default attitude. It doesn't tell us particularly much about how we do or might proceed in developing our understanding of the world or on what's going on when we theorise and experiment. So I think we can see a potentially more fruitful role for optimism by looking at how it might affect us in more extreme cases, like coyotes, when the ground is whipped out from under us. So as Mark Wilson points out, many of the most interesting questions in philosophy concern the issues of how we should proceed in the periods when we patiently await fuller enlightenment. So I'm going to look at just a few cases in physics, maths and logic where it seems this sort of ground whipping happens. So I'm just going to have some water. Or has happened, and hope that by examining these cases we can distill something common across some of the attitudes that we might take in that situation that might be described as optimism, so fitting our initial definition of running in midair, and also might be described as optimism about aboutness, so metaphysical, and see if then what we've distilled might indeed prove useful in some way. So just a note, before I quickly go over all these examples, I'm going to omit nearly every single technical detail in all of them. So if you are interested, there's links on the final slide to where you might go to find out more. Well, when you're looking for situations like coyotes, physics is a great place to start, particularly quantum mechanics. So we only need to start with superposition, the idea of superposition, but there's so much in quantum mechanics that could fit the bill of hanging out over in midair and hopefully pedaling your feet. Superposition is basically, as far as I understand it, what happens to atoms and other stuff passing through various apparatus designed to measure their properties. It turns out that none of our notions regarding the possibilities for what might be going on apply here. And probably the easiest example to sort of hopefully demonstrate the hanging in midair feeling is the two-slit experiment. So what's going on here is electrons are shot through a little gate, little opening, the rest is an electron blocker. When they're shot through one gate, they make a little heap, just like a bunch of particles would make a little pile. Same thing happens if you shut the other gate, and there's only one gate open, they make a little heap. If you open both gates, they don't make two little heaps, they make a wave pattern, as if they were flowing through like a wave. In that situation where the two gates are open, as David Elbert puts it, it's inconsistent with these experimental results to suppose that an electron passing through this apparatus when both gates are open, that it passes through the upper hole. It's inconsistent to suppose that it passes through the lower hole. It can't be maintained that it passes through both, and it can't be maintained that it passes through neither. And so to quote Elbert again, the electrons are then in superposition of passing through the upper hole and passing through the lower, but we have no idea, or only a negative idea, of what that means. Electrons seem to have modes of being or modes of moving available to them which are quite unlike anything we know how to think about. And the name of that new mode, which is just a name for something we don't understand, to quote Elbert again, is superposition. Now, there are and there were lots of different attitudes we could take to this sort of result. And two quite well-known ones are Einstein's and Bohr's. Einstein was convinced there's something wrong with the formalisms here, with what's going on, and he wanted to find out more. Whereas Bohr took a more kind of fatalist approach. Put very crudely, in some sense, the Copenhagen or Bohr's interpretation is just another way of saying we don't know what it's all about. We don't know what quantum mechanics is all about, and we shouldn't. We just have to live with it. We have to live with it, the predicament that it presents our conceptual apparatus. For a nice dramatic way of putting it, which I lifted from a slide from a University of Oregon lecturer, Bohr admonished those who continued to wonder what an electron really is, a wave or a particle. He denounced the question as meaningless or without context. I thought that was lovely. A famous quote, he used to say, it's as silly as asking what's north of the North Pole. So to observe the properties of an electron for Bohr is just to conduct some sort of experiment. Experiments designed to measure waves, we'll see waves. Experiments designed to measure particles, we'll see particles. No experiment can ever measure both simultaneously, which is their complementary properties. And there's others, most famously position and momentum that people would know about. So they're things that are not simultaneously knowable. This is the approach to take. We never see a mixture of a wave and a particle. This is very, very quick, no technical details really, but and it actually, Bohr was probably more complicated than this. He probably was a bit of a metaphysicist as well. But the bit that's interesting, at least to help pinpoint what metaphysical optimism might look like, is his insistence that we don't go beyond the formalism or the paradox. And supporters of the Copenhagen interpretation often end up sounding a bit like Bishop Berkeley. This is actually a quote from Bohr. There's no quantum world, there's only quantum, abstract quantum description. And according to Louisa Gilder, Bohr's books and papers were indeed full of very careful prohibitions about what cannot be contemplated. Karen Barad gets a little more to the heart of the matter when she notes that for Bohr, complementarity was almost a religious belief, that the paradoxes of the quantum world must be accepted as fundamental, not to be solved, or trivialised by attempts to find out what's really going on down there. He emphasised that waves and particles are abstractions, their properties being definable and observable only through their interaction with other classical systems. He did not envisage ways of moving beyond these abstractions to more accurate descriptions. So, insofar as Bohr's view involves this sort of embargo on aboutness, I'm going to characterise it as an example of the absence of metaphysical optimism. I don't want to say the opposite because I don't want to invoke pessimism. I think that's going to muddy the waters. But Einstein, remember his position was essentially that something's wrong here. It was the opposite impulse. It was the feeling that we should be asking what it's all about, that the formalisms are not telling us enough, and they should be. That there's more to know in this case, and we need to keep working until we find out more. A famous quote from Einstein is, "I still believe in the possibility of a model of reality, of a theory which represents things themselves." So that was against Bohr. And this, I'm going to say, is an example of metaphysical optimism. It's this approach, actually, that underpinned major discovery in quantum mechanics of entanglement, albeit unintentionally. It came from the idea that there were missing or hidden variables explaining the weird actions of electrons. The paper that kickstarted it all was the title was actually called "Can a Quantum Mechanical Description of Physical Reality Be Considered Complete?" That's a rhetorical question. Now, I've glossed over quite a lot here, but the interesting bit about all this for our topic is when we go where the formalisms or our theories lead us, and we find we've just stepped over a ledge into thin air, we've got at least two options as to what to do next. There's Bohr's way, it was also Heisenberg's and Pauli's, explaining things as best we can, but in a sense just learning to live with it. Learning to live with nothing beneath our feet, in this case. And there's Einstein's, there was also de Broglie's and Schrödinger's. And that's looking for something more comprehensible than thin air. So keeping on peddling. Some way of seeing what's really going on. So perhaps for quantum mechanics, or at least this bit of it, metaphysical optimism is the idea that we can still know or know more of what it's about, or at least that it's still worth asking the question. So on this view, what the formalisms themselves say is not all we have to wonder about or work with. There's also the question of what they're about. Now, moving on from physics, we have maths. Gödel took this whole attitude that I'm starting to sort of distill and pinpoint of metaphysical optimism a step or two further. For Gödel, optimism was more than a way of thinking. It was a methodology for both maths and philosophy. Gödel said that the meaning of the world is the separation and its overcoming of fact and wish. Now, it's interesting to compare that with Wilson's comments on the Adventures of Applied Mathematics, in which he says, we see an appreciation of the unavoidable divergences between fond hope and supportive reality. But that's a little aside. Now, the main story I want to go over in mathematics is a very well-known one, and that's of the incompleteness theorems in Hilbert's program. So I'm going to go very quickly here and just look at the bits that are relevant to maybe pinpointing what metaphysical optimism might amount to. Hilbert's particular brand of optimism was that for any mathematical question we ask in a consistent system, there'll be a yes or no answer we can find. Hilbert's program aimed to formalise all of maths via finitary methods and demonstrate that the system itself is consistent. So that was Hilbert's program in a nutshell. But then Gödel's incompleteness theorems happened. The first theorem basically says any consistent system, if you can do a little bit of arithmetic in it, will have statements that can neither be proved nor disproved. Also, it can't show that it's consistent, assuming that it is. Richard Dack's encyclopedia piece on Hilbert's program says in something of an understatement, Gödel's incompleteness theorem showed that Hilbert's optimism was undue. Gödel, though, didn't rule out the discovery of answers to our mathematical questions, although he's the one that came up with these theorems and proved them. But his attitude was quite different to Hilbert's. He believed in mathematical intuition. He said, intuition is not proof. It's the opposite of proof. We don't analyse intuition to see a proof, but by intuition, we see something without a proof, or to be Scottish and more to the point about it, out with a proof, something beyond. So for Gödel, there's the proof, and there's what the proof is about. And Gödel argued that thinking this way is actually what was essential to his results. So Gödel was an optimist, but quite a specific one. His faith was in our ability to access an independent mathematical reality. Hilbert could be called a mathematical optimist. His faith, though, was in the formalism. Bohr could be called an optimist in the same way. His faith was also in the formalism. But I'm going to characterise both Hilbert and Bohr's attitudes more as humility, and I'll get to that in a minute. So in lots of ways, and not just for Hilbert, Gödel's incompleteness theorems were a coyote moment in maths, a moment where the ground has been whipped out from under us. But another one is the independence results. There's been a proliferation of these since the first discovery, which came about by a method known as forcing. Now, forcing has created a whole sort of field of its own in maths of producing independence results. Now, an independence result is a theorem or a hypothesis that has a model in which it's true and a model in which it's false, using the basic axioms of set theory. The most famous independence result is the continuum hypothesis, and in its easiest to understand form, it's the idea that there's no infinity with a size between the small infinity of the integers and the big infinity of the reals. Now, there's a model in which that's true, and there's a model in which that's false. So it's independent, so it can't be proved one way or the other. As Stilwell said, forcing completely changed the face of set theory, and so of maths, by showing that most of the interesting unproved sentences in set theory can be neither proved nor disproved without new axioms. And in particular, it can be used to obtain models with all these properties. And nowadays, it's actually pretty much a whole industry of its own in maths, and I've got a link at the end to a bunch of independence results for arithmetic, if you're interested. Now, as Gaifman says, the majority of mathematicians hate to entertain the possibility that the problem they work on has no solution. Not surprising, because it's independent of the main axioms of set theory. He once heard Paul Erdős say in a lecture on number theory, hopefully this kind of problem doesn't fall prey to the monster of independence. But there are, nonetheless, similar options here as to what to do next, as there were for quantum mechanics. On the one hand, there's a sort of pulling back to what we do know. And this idea manifests in a number of practical ways. But one interesting way is the idea that we should be very careful to ask only natural questions. And that's natural questions in this context means questions naturally generated within a particular mathematical research area, hopefully not too much related to set theory, to avoid an independence result. for an answer. So it's pulling back, asking natural questions, hoping to goodness that you can't be modelled in set theory and proven to be independent. So this sort of attitude takes the independence results as a dead end, beyond which we can't go. And it again is a sort of embargo, I think, on further wonderings about what's going on. If you hit an independence result, you've hit a wall, you've jumped off a cliff. And so it's not metaphysical optimism. But there are others, Wooden, for example, and something known as the California School, who adopt an attitude that I think is able to be described as metaphysical optimism. They might look for new axioms to decide these questions. The California School is actually looking for new axioms to decide the continuum hypothesis one way or the other. And the interesting thing, Stilwell says, Wooden described forcing this way. It really is the end of set theory, or else it's really the beginning, and we don't know which. And as Stilwell says, it may be that we can never understand the continuum, but it may also be that we can understand the continuum only by new axioms. And he calls that idea, the latter view, the optimistic view, and I agree. And this was also Gödel's attitude. It was essentially the attitude of saying, regardless of what you think of the current status of our knowledge, there's still hope for improvement, for elucidation, and believing that it's worth continuing to ask, what is it about? So there are lots of places in maths where the formalisms don't seem to be telling us anything, or where they seem to be telling us something very strange that we apparently just can't understand, just like in quantum physics. Now, logic. I told you this was going to be quick. There are quite a few cloudy moments in logic. Okay, one of them would be the paradoxes of material implication. Here's one. The moon is made of green cheese, therefore either it's raining in Ecuador now or it's not. Here's another. It's raining and it's not raining, therefore the moon is made of green cheese. They're both valid arguments. So I'm feeling like I just jumped off a cliff. They're valid arguments. No, they're not. Yes, they are. They're valid arguments in classical logic, but clearly they're not. Now, there are at least two options as to what to do here. One is to try to kind of explain away or to pull back from the paradoxes, and amounts effectively to a pulling back to classical logic. And to do that, you have to bar the exceptions in some way, or pull back and argue that they're not as dangerous looking as they appear. And the other, though, which gave birth to the whole host of alternative logics that you probably know about, is to continue to look and to wonder at what's going on. Stephen Reid, in his book on relevance logic, which is an alternative logic, says the puzzles and paradoxes of classical logic are removed not by barring exceptions or by restricting its application, but by a proof analysis which discerns the true nature of consequence of the notion of validity. So that's continuing to wonder what it's about. But then one class of the alternative logics, and that's paraconsistent logics, also produces a coyote moment of their own in logic. So the next coyote moment in logic actually comes about via the alternative logics. It has seemed to be, to a lot of people, to be another place where we've just leapt off into thin air, where we have a whole bunch of theories and formalisms and ideas that seem to be telling us nothing, or seem to be telling us something very strange that we just can't understand, just like in quantum physics. So the motivating idea behind paraconsistent logic is that contradictory premises, like it's raining and it's not raining, can be meaningful in the sense that some things follow from them and some things don't. So the reason why the first argument was valid is because in classical logic, if I say a contradiction, well then, it's all bets are off. Anything follows. So the moon can be made of green cheese if it's raining and not raining. Paraconsistent logic, on the other hand, says the contradiction itself can be meaningful. Some things do follow from it, some things don't. Now, when it first started really being talked about, there were plenty who couldn't accept it. And perhaps the prime example is David Lewis, although there are still many philosophers around who can't accept paraconsistent logic. But for Lewis, in his Logic for Equivocators, said, this proposal amounts to a generalization to other realms of the plea that God is not bound by human logic. He went on to say, the reason we should reject this proposal is simple. No truth does have, and no truth could have, a true negation. Nothing is and nothing could be, literally both true and false. But then he famously declined to defend this claim, arguing that it was indefensible against the paraconsistent challenge. He said, "Paraconsistent logicians have called so much into question that I have no foothold on undisputed ground." So there you go, he's off in midair, he's jumped off a cliff. And this is a bit like the quantum mechanical situation. We generally do not comprehend contradictions. And the idea that we should allow them can be responded to in the same two ways that we saw in the quantum mechanical example. So one of the options we have here is the optimistic one. We can follow where the formalisms lead and yet also hope for a deeper understanding or a firmer footing. And many paraconsistent logicians actually do feel that true contradictions happen, and they are in an important sense, in the sense that some things follow from them, some things don't, about something. Maybe they're about the true nature of consequence. Maybe it's something to do with dialethea, but they're not empty or simply incomprehensible formalisms with which we can do nothing except watch our whole deductive system explode. So, what have we come up with? Well, across these few examples that we've had a look at, there's something that's happening as a response across, so for a number of people, responding to jumping off a cliff or feeling like you're hanging in midair. We go as far as it seems we can go, but we look further still. And that's the pedaling, the feet pedaling. Then there's another response, which is go as far as it seems we can, but pull back to what it seems or what we believe we can know. And so I'm calling the pulling back humility and the continuing to pedal optimism. And that's why I'm calling Hilbert and Bohr's attitude humility there. But the main point regarding optimism that I think we can pick up from the examples is this. In practice, when it seems we've come across a sort of boundary condition on possible knowledge, we do go beyond, or at least we acknowledge it as an option. In each of the cases that we've looked at, it may seem, and it has seemed to many, as though we've gone as far as we can, or we've gone as far as we should. But in each case, hoping to go further is nonetheless taken to be a reasonable strategy to others. Okay, that's the example bit. Done. The main philosophy bit now. Let's take a bit of a closer look at this attitude that we might be distilling, or the methodology perhaps that's happening across all these moments, all these examples. Now again, Mark Wilson's a good one to look to here. He goes some way toward characterising the sort of thing that I think might be happening here, or the sort of way in which it might be useful in his wandering significance. In that, he paints a picture of our stumbling but genuine approach to reality or to nature, of then nature's recalcitrance in the face of our determination to understand, but then our adjusting and continuing our efforts in the face of that recalcitrance. So in Wilson's picture, the physical universe is a rambunctious child and the philosopher is a photographer who needs to find odd and roundabout strategies if he hopes to capture a glimpse of the flighty universe upon his linguistic film. So we can perhaps begin to characterise a useful optimism as persisting with these strategies or envisaging new ones in the hope that they can somehow, some way, help us see. Now, Wilson agrees with Hume that we tend somewhat to over-enthusiastic optimism, but he doesn't conclude that an optimistic strategy is always unwarranted or misleading. Indeed, he points out that our grasp of a concept can itself be, quote, delivered via the midwifery of misunderstanding and false optimism. And that even when quite wildly wrong or quite overblown, our genetic inclination to seek unmerited certainty has an important methodological role in the history of scientific process and the mastery of concepts in general. But Wilson does also argue that while we can hope for conceptual mastery or complete understanding to be maximally useful, those hopes should be checked by what he calls patient temperance. And his own strategy is quite moderate in terms of optimism. So he aims to bring our conceptual expectations into alignment with what's humanly feasible without utterly shutting the door on our capacities to improve our usage in rigour and clarity. And so I guess my suggestion here at its more moderate end, so that this to me is very moderate, is something similar. That what's going on here, that what might be useful, is that the idea that we should not shut the door on the expansion of our current conception of what is humanly feasible. So that's as far as Wilson takes it. But for me, this also includes not shutting the door on entirely unexplained or unexpected ways that the universal reality can make itself known to us. So there might be a gift of unprovoked revelation or inspiration or the role of intuition, for which sometimes at least we can really take little credit aside from having been there when it happens or being able to see or receive it. So if you imagine the photography metaphor again, the glimpse owes as much to what shows itself within our range or reach as it does to our instruments of perception or reception. And again, this suggests that a useful optimism is one that gives credence and attention to the idea of a beyond what we believe to be the limits of our epistemic capacities. Beyond what it currently seems we can even possibly feasibly know, or what it seems our theories can possibly tell us. So one of the first and perhaps one of the most important things to notice about this useful optimism, again keeping in mind the image of the photographer, is the way that then reality can surprise us. And I think in many ways that actually this attitude itself nurtures the conditions that need to be in place for such a surprise to have even a chance of happening. Perhaps we wouldn't point and shoot or try other roundabout strategies in the first place unless we hoped something would turn up on our film. But again, a key element of Wilson's picture is the need for a balance between optimism and something that we're going to call humility. Without this sort of balance, we might get a somewhat less useful optimism. Perhaps it'd be one running unchecked to all sorts of strange certainties or up all sorts of garden paths. But on the flip side, I think an excess of humility can also lead us astray. And to have a look a bit more at what humility might be in this context and how the two relate, we can look at Nancy Holland, who has explored humility in quite some depth. She characterises something called ontological humility as a philosophical stance that acknowledges the limitations of intellect and will and the randomness of both our blessings and our burdens. And this is an approach to what she calls the transcendent condition of our being. And it acknowledges the centrality of that transcendent condition, but it limits our role in understanding it to one of unprovoked revelation, a bit like what I just mentioned. But for Holland, it's one of random receptivity at best. So our experience here comes about only via what is given. So our role is limited to being given to. And our resulting relationship with what it is that gives or reveals may not in the end look much like what we'd ordinarily think of as knowledge. So she differentiates between this attitude and epistemological humility, which is a bit more straightforward. It's humility about the nature, extent, and reliability of human knowledge. Now, I agree that both sorts of humility are useful and wise. And most particularly, I agree that a profound conviction or even a profound absolute hope for absolute certainty or the belief in a knowledge that cannot be doubted is generally undesirable and can in fact hobble discovery. But I'm not sure that acknowledging the necessity and importance of doubt or humility regarding human knowledge, so the epistemological bit, should then rule anything out. In particular, I'm not convinced that epistemological humility does or should entail or go hand in hand with what Holland's ontological humility threatens to look like or starts to look like across some of the pages, which is a kind of withdrawing from any hope of knowledge or of setting limits, preconceived, preconceded boundary lines, limits on modes of possible reception. I'm not convinced that if we admit that knowledge can be doubted, we should then also set or emphasise a boundary beyond which our hope for knowledge or our deliberate attention and our deliberate purpose cannot or ought not go beyond hoping for a random receptivity. Metaphysical optimism is looking, or more to the point, hoping to look beyond our own putative boundaries, even toward the transcendent condition of our being. It's the idea that we can approach what appears out of reach positively and not without hope that such an approach will be fruitful and may even yield knowledge or something like it. Now, I think our quick examples in the first half of the talk show that there's at least no guarantee that a general methodological retreat or resignation is better than the practice of hope, even at their extreme or perhaps unhinged ends, There's no guarantee that one way as a methodology is always going to be better than the other. And this is particularly so as a way of proceeding in the face of the apparently ineffable. To go over this a little bit more carefully, Holland does actually define ontological humility elsewhere. And then she, in this definition, she brings out that she does actually mean unknown and unknowable, and that humility is an attitude that is taken toward what is set to be beyond or transcendent to knowledge, so it transcends knowledge. The point I'm trying to make here is that adopting only this sort of conception of humility, or adopting humility in this form, can take us too far in one direction, and that's away from hope. After all, as Holland herself acknowledges elsewhere, quote, to think we have absolute knowledge, even absolute knowledge that no knowledge is possible, is to deny human limitations. So too heavily underscoring the unknowability of what transcends or lies beyond those human limitations, or too quickly narrowing the range of modes by which we could possibly understand or relate to it, is, I think, and somewhat paradoxically, an overreach. It's granting those human limitations undue power. The metaphysically optimistic approach, on the other hand, says we don't know what we can't know, not even regarding the fundamental background of our existence. It recognises that there are limitations to our knowledge, but it sees that these limitations include knowing precisely what the limitations themselves are, what they mean, how far they reach, and when and in which contexts they operate. So again, the suggestion here is not that humility should be avoided, but that as much as humility, optimism should be, as it were, on the table, seen as a viable, legitimate strategy in the course of our inquiries. And as we've seen, ontological humility is not the only way to go when we look in other contexts. In physics, maths and logic, we saw that something like ontological humility, so deciding or telling the ineffable that it's unknowable, or resigning ourselves to either a fundamental impasse or the patient awaiting of gifted revelation, was only one of at least two options. There was also the metaphysically optimistic option in each case. And in each of our examples, that option can be understood as approaching what's beyond comprehension with the hope that it won't or won't forever remain that way. So from our initial sketch of humility and optimism, here's a drawing of humility and optimism, we can see that the approaching rather than the pulling back marks an important difference between the two, as much as does the putative boundary lines or the restrictions to the modes of possible operation. So to genuinely approach, though, we need to step or to imagine beyond any such lines or restrictions, rather than to stand behind or stay within them. To look to know, to try to see, even where it seems that knowing and seeing is impossible. So in the context of Holland's transcendent, if we take humility to be the sort of methodology or strategy of not allowing or admitting the possibility that we can know, then we can see how metaphysical optimism and humility may be in tension with one another in this context. Metaphysical optimism as a general strategy hopes to know, or at least at the very least, it sees the point in actively wondering and in actively approaching. That's not to say, though, that optimism can't work with humility. So the cooperation might actually look something like Holland quotes, this is from Heidegger, might look something like this. Only if we become truly humble is the scent awakened for what is great, and only if this occurs do we become capable of wonder. So if we think of wonder as a kind of optimism, this might begin to explain a way that the two can work together. But I'd like to explore this a little bit more. How can the two work together? To do this, I think we need to notice something about metaphysical optimism. It grants, on the one hand, that our knowledge, okay, is separate from what it is knowledge of, so that the two can come apart. That's an important part of metaphysical optimism. There's a knowledge, and it's what our knowledge is of, that we've seen in all the examples. So because of that, we've got a kind of fallibility. We've got the knowing that we might anticipate, or the knowing that we hope for, as well as the knowing that we've established so far, or established knowledge. It's not necessarily tied down to one particular approach, perspective, or formalism. And so in that sense, it's doubtable. in the particular sense that it's not presumed to be an inherent part of any one particular epistemological root. After all, that's just another way of saying what we see is different or differentiable from how we see it. So in this way, metaphysical optimism can work with epistemological humility, because it's doubtable. But note again that metaphysical optimism can encompass the active hope that what is transcendent will show itself. Bear in mind the picture of the photographer again, the image of the trying to find roundabout strategies. And so in this way, it can actually work with ontological humility. For example, our approach itself might be an openness to reception, a respectful, careful attention, rather than a grasping or presuming. So we might be really careful because the universe is being very rambunctious. And in fact, metaphysical optimism takes as a key aspect of its whole sort of way of being and the whole everything we see in examples, this thing called attention epistemology that comes from Iris Murdoch, well, it started with, as its starting point. And that's the idea that the direction of our attention should properly be outward, away from self. So Murdoch also talks about how the idea that we just outlined, so of our knowledge as separable or detachable from what it's knowledge of, is itself related to the idea of transcendence. She says, she sort of brings it out in quite a longish quote, but I'll quote all of it because it's quite beautiful. She says, one can see the relation, particularly in the case of our apprehension of beauty. The link here is the concept of indestructibility or incorruptibility. What is truly beautiful is inaccessible and cannot be possessed or destroyed. Great art teaches us how real things can be looked at and loved without being seized and used, without being appropriated into the greedy organism of the self. The experience of detachment is difficult and valuable, whether the thing contemplated is a human being, or the root of a tree, or the vibration of a colour or a sound. End quote. But this underscores the point I was trying to make earlier, that our optimistically hoped for access can and perhaps often should, in fact, be a kind of stepping back or a detached letting things be, as Holland characterises Heideggerian unconcealing. But as Holland points out, Heidegger was both optimistic and humble regarding this idea. He did allow for, or he hoped for, the idea that we could concern ourselves with the concealed, or the other phrase he used was the unthought. My point is that that hope, the hope that we can concern ourselves, or that we can indeed let things be, itself can remain one of wonder and can still operate from the idea of access or positive, hopeful approach. It's just that in these cases, the access we hope for may be more of what Heidegger calls a sort of unconcealment or an unthinking than a construction, understanding, or even a thinking. But so long as we allow this, so long as we allow that that kind of surrender or submitting or letting things be is an approach as well, then ontological humility and metaphysical optimism are almost one and the same, perhaps just viewed from different angles or with different emphasis. And in that case, we could argue that Heidegger's recommendation here, that we submit to what thinking has to think about, itself describes a kind of hybrid, a kind of optimistic humility. So I agree with Murdoch's valuing of the notion of inaccessibility and with Holland's central or motivating conception for her humility. That is, I agree that the notion of the independence of the object or subject of our inquiry from that inquiry itself can, and in many ways should, incorporate the idea of some sort of inner core or an element of inaccessibility and unknowability, insofar as it should grant that our theories and our knowledge can never encapsulate every single aspect of what they're about. Again, if they could, the difference between the two would collapse. But I also agree insofar as such an approach respects the fundamental otherness of what it approaches. But we've just seen how thinking this way can nurture the potential for surprise, can motivate revisiting existing notions of how our inquiries could and should turn out. That is, there's a positive side to all this. Such an attitude opens and enables and invites. But the problem is that this attitude, the idea of inaccessibility by itself, can and often does, in the literature, collapse into scepticism or, more to the point in this case, resignation. It can prevent our hopeful, optimistic approach, or it can turn our gaze away. So I would argue that both stances, Holland's ontological humility and my metaphysical optimism, when left unchecked by the other, run the same risk. And that's the risk of becoming something more like arrogance, of, to quote Holland, reducing reality or what our theories are about to nothing more than we can know about it. Holland, though, along with a number of other authors, and that's an understatement, in the philosophical tradition, associates this risk only with one extreme, and that's with a lack of ontological humility or an excess of optimism. But if ontological humility becomes a declaration at the outset, and I think we're always at the outset, or perhaps it's more accurate to say we don't know that we're not, that what might be beyond or transcend what we can epistemologically access, or beyond what our theories or formalisms suggest, is just fundamentally always, or in some particular circumscribable way, say accepting passive random reception, not approachable or knowable, then it would, I suggest, be as arrogant as any position declaring that the transcendent is entirely knowable. So they both run the same risk. For all that, though, I don't think we should rule out the more arrogant extreme ends here, as sometimes workable strategies themselves. Unchecked humility, for instance, can play a crucial role in developing constructive solutions. But equally, unchecked optimism can provide solutions, perhaps more surprising solutions. So we can offer up examples after examples of rigorously or constructively won insight and progress. But we can also offer examples of insight and progress that seem to have come from nowhere like they're supposed to. And so too, from allowing the possibility that they might. I think Ramanujan's a good example. His insight didn't come from a rigorous mathematical understanding of mathematical formalisms. Gödel, in another way, is another example. And perhaps to Einstein, say when he wondered, what if something could go beyond the speed of light? Or other Gedanken and thought experiments of Einstein's, or even by his envisaging of complete theories, and for Gödel, his envisaging of the role and importance of intuition. Those insights can't always be put down to or reduced to sudden leaps within a system of thought. At times, they seem genuinely to look at that system from an entirely other angle. And at those times, the image of an explorer might be more apt than of a constructive or necessarily rational thinker. So then we have more of an image of perhaps wondering or wandering, stumbling across, rather than building or even leaping to new insight. So you can offer examples from both extreme ends, might work in some cases. But it's also interesting to note that at each of those extreme ends, or unchecked cases where each might turn to arrogance, we have a totalizing or universalizing in some way. So unchecked optimism might say, we definitely know, and what we know is certainly truth. Unchecked humility might say, we know how to know, and all that lies beyond or falls outside of this is fundamentally not accessible, or accessible only in certain prescribed or limited ways and modes. And so indeed, perhaps both sorts of arrogance, although they may work in some exceptional cases, are more generally or usefully to be avoided if we want, on the one hand, to have the best chance to discover, or on the other hand, to remain open to possibility or to changing our mind. Now, interestingly, Holland claims that ontological humility, and perhaps we could add when it's working at its best, allows us to see beyond claims of certain knowledge. The interesting thing is that the same can be claimed for metaphysical optimism, especially if we replace certain with possible. But to get to this midpoint where they're both working that way, for either position to do that most effectively, again, one must be checked by the other. So optimism may be at its best, or perhaps better to say again, most generally useful, when it's pulled back by humility. So when it approaches with respect, say, love and detachment. Equally though, humility may be at its best or its most useful when it's pulled toward optimism, becoming then less an attitude of we can't go beyond and more one of, but maybe we might. So just to finish off, I want to take a look, as I said I would, at how all this might apply to older divisions and perspectives in philosophy, and in particular to realism-anti-realism divide. Now, the first thing to notice here is that key elements of the medium position, so not to hang too tightly to either our theories or what we hope those theories are about, can be found across both realist and anti-realist views. So, for example, an anti-realist can adopt an optimistic strategy. Perhaps they could proceed as if there's something beyond our theories or our thought, that we could imagine there's something there that we could discover. You could perhaps adopt that idea as a sort of Kantian regulative ideal. Or the other way an anti-realist could adopt an optimistic strategy would be by limiting the hope to the potential expansion of our capacity rather than of discovery. And Wilson's vision of the possible expansion of human capacity then can work both realistically and anti-realistically in that sense. But that's insofar as we consider metaphysical optimism as a practice or as a strategy. When we start to consider it as a belief or an idea, and that's the belief that what our theories and talk are about is really more than or different from the theories and talk itself, then it does line up more with realism, or at least with a particular element of realism. I think it's important to note here that the correspondence not with only one sort of realism, say with realism traditionally conceived. At first it might seem like optimism as a belief is correlated only with a particular strong realism, say the idea that our formalisms can or should tell us something about an independently determinate, unchanging, fixed, all these type of ideas that come out of realism in the literature, real world. But metaphysical optimism by itself doesn't prescribe how the world should turn out or what it might be like or what it should be like beyond separable from our theories or thought about it. At least it doesn't need to in order to be the sort of potent, useful type of thing that's going on where we looked at the examples in the examples. It just needs to believe that whatever our theories are about should be considered for its own sake. That's what came out of the examples, as distinguished or distinguishable from the ways in which we talk and think about it. Individual positions incorporating optimistic attitude can, of course, prescribe or overlay expectations on how this stuff should be. So it could have elements of a strong realism or perhaps elements of arrogance as well. For example, according to some accounts, Einstein was pretty adamant that the world should be made up of separable bits. But that's not the only metaphysically optimistic way to think about the world. I'd say that John Bell was a metaphysical optimist, because for Bell, the Copenhagen-style attitude, the notion that the quantum mechanical formalisms were enough, or as he put it, just fine for all practical purposes, was itself not enough. He wanted more from them. He felt we needed to ask more from them, that they give us a clear, thorough understanding of exactly what they're saying about reality. So he was immensely interested in the question of what quantum mechanics was about. And he, for example, he explored the potential difference between something he called observables and beables. But contra Einstein, Bell's inequality means entangled quantum particles have either non-locality or non-separability. Now, while it's conceivable one might be in some sense a realist about such particles, it's a very different realism than the traditional version, with its emphasis on how things should turn out to be, say, separable, local, identifiable, determinate. And Wilson's rather pragmatic realism is another case in point. Wilson brings the real world into his theory of concepts, simply as the common sense idea that there are subjective structures of conceptualization and there are real world correlates of these subjective structures, and that the two can be untangled from one another, more or less successfully, with more or less effort, depending on the context. But again, this is not to commit to the real world conforming to a particular set of beliefs about exactly what it should be. It's just to bring that real world and the idea of our concepts being about it simply but squarely back into the picture. So we have two ways of thinking about metaphysical optimism, as a strategy and as a belief. Utilising the first, so envisaging the scale incorporating from humility to optimism as a sort of spectrum of possible strategies, gives us a new way of thinking about practical elements of the positions in the older divide, or the older spectrum from anti-realism to realism, insofar as it picks out some of the essential elements of what each position might boil down to in practice, or how each position might be practiced in philosophy. But in this case, though, of course, as you can see, neither spectrum neatly correlates with the other. So another way in which it's actually useful, then, thinking about it this way, is the way in which it motivates an ecumenical approach toward the strategies that it encompasses. So an anti-realist can adopt an optimistic attitude. A realist can be humble. But again, this is if we conceive of the idea of metaphysical optimism as a strategy. As a belief, it correlates at one end with realism, at the other with anti-realism. To explore these relationships a bit more carefully, and in particular, to look at the relationship between the idea or the belief of metaphysical optimism and realism and how this might be useful, again, we can turn to Iris Murdoch. Murdoch's often at pains to remind philosophers that how we think and believe, how we see and describe the world, are among our choices, just as much as how we act. In On God and Good, she highlights the importance of belief. She defends in that the notion of a perfect, transcendent, non-representable and necessarily real object of attention. That then she goes on to say it's an idea which, as belief, has the power to modify the meanings of our words, to inspire and to illuminate. And it has an ethical connotation for Murdoch. But she adds that if the notion is adopted simply as a psychological device or as a strategy, its potency is lost. So she says, in order to be most effective, it needs to be a genuine belief and not an acting as if. And perhaps a similar argument might be offered regarding metaphysical optimism. To be most effective in ordering our ideas, enriching the potential for discovery of new and surprising truths, it might need to be adopted as a belief and not simply as a strategy. It may be that the strategy is at its most effective and interesting when it takes the metaphysical idea seriously. So my final point makes a return to the notion of transcendence. As Murdoch, in the same essay, ably illustrates, just as there's a relationship between metaphysical optimism as belief and realism, there's a relationship between both and the idea of transcendence. But on this, I want to move away from Murdoch for a minute and back to Wilson. I want to draw attention to a funny trick that Wilson pulls as an argument for one of his, for his own particular common sense realism. He quotes a passage criticising metaphysical realism, in which the author speaks in general terms about the sort of reality and our relationship to it that the author takes metaphysical realism to involve in order to attack it. So the quote is, "The idea behind metaphysical realism is that we can conceive of the entities and substances and species of the external world independently of the empirical beliefs and theories we hold or might hold in the future. Metaphysical realism imagines we can completely distinguish between what we believe and think about the things to which we refer on the one hand and the pure truth about these things on the other." Said as if this is utterly ridiculous, I'm trying to imbue that in my tone. And Wilson actually grants that described in these sweeping terms, metaphysical realism sounds rather foolish. But then he lowers the level of abstraction and he substitutes the word rabbit for the generally referred to independent stuff throughout. Now it reads, "The idea behind metaphysical realism is that we can conceive of rabbits and their liking for carrots independently of any of the empirical beliefs and theories we might hold or hold in the future. Metaphysical realism imagines that we can completely distinguish between what we believe and think about rabbits and their favourite food on the one hand and the pure truth about these things on the other." And as Wilson points out, it now doesn't sound like such a foolish policy after all. So what I hope I've begun to establish so far in this talk might support a version of exactly this argument, but turned upside down. So during this talk, we've noted just a few of the many key places in the history of physics, logic and maths, wherein some great minds have proceeded on the conviction that there's something worth wondering about, worth acknowledging and attempting to see beyond what we know and even beyond what it seems we can possibly know. And we've noted that this conviction has played, and it's been rationally, reasonably acknowledged as playing, a crucial or at least a respected role in deepening our understanding and progressing a field. But now we can note that if we grant those cases are acceptable, perhaps we can't so easily rule against the more sweeping versions of the same idea in other contexts. Wilson's point is that, quote, "we should not allow scare-quoted phrases such as an imagined external reality to persuade us that everyday assertions such as rabbits refers to rabbits represent some wild-eyed form of metaphysics comparable to belief in astral projection." My point is that equally, we should be careful not to confine our metaphysical beliefs to rabbits. As I touched on at the beginning of the talk, To presume there's a special set or type of thing that our wondering or thinking has to be about in order to qualify as metaphysics at the outset is to beg the question. Equally, when we come to contemplate the reasonableness or otherwise of such metaphysical ideas in abstract or highly contentious contexts, such as the traditional realist belief in transcendent truth, truth beyond the edge of our knowledge, we shouldn't ignore what's happened and is still happening in other fields or in more everyday contexts. Most particularly, we shouldn't ignore strategies or ideas that have been accepted as reasonable and rational and have proved fruitful when those fields have come coyote-like to their own edges, where apparent halts and boundaries to our knowledge seem to have left us dangling in midair. As Murdoch points out, just because it seems we can't establish the transcendent by philosophical argument doesn't mean we can't or ought not believe it. Believe in it, more to the point. So another way of making the point that I'm trying to make here is I hope I've begun an argument against the sort of anti-transcendent, anti-realist, anti-anything outside the scientific method or reason or rationality that abound in the philosophical literature. And a smattering of examples here that I won't read out, that they also abound elsewhere, not just in the philosophical literature. And I'm talking to varying degrees about these ideas here, which I won't read out, but now I'll invite questions and let you read them yourselves.